There you are. Drink plenty of water. Hey, Brian.
Yeah?
Thanks for listening.
Boy, that was more disturbing than that cartoon I saw the other day.
I know what I did was super dumb. I'm so sorry.
It's too late. You want nothing to do with you. Ever again.
My COVID era is not serving. I've been depressed, anxious, failing my classes, binge eating, and watching She-Ra. So you know I was in a dark place. But during that time, I filled the ever-expanding void in my life with cartoons. Cartoons will forever hold a special place in my heart, second only to Monty and my girlfriend. I have many fond memories of watching cartoons on the floor of my Nana's dusty carpet with my cousins on those Arizona summers. Like Niao Kai Lan, Octonauts, Chowder, oh, all of those were on my mind back then. I didn't have to worry about late-stage capitalism, 5.5 million people dying, only Jayus, you know, things that are on the same level of severity. But my point is that I wasn't in the right headspace. But just recently, I've started bettering myself for the better. I've been working out, got new friends, eating better, and watching better shows, one of which being The Owl House. Now, this video is not about The Owl House. That show deserves at least 20 videos because of how good it is, but, like, because I was watching The Owl House, I ended up on The Owl House TikTok. On it was everything a suicidal preteen could want. People thirsting over mommies? You got it. People thirsting over old, disgusting, moldy white men? You got it. Gay people? You got it. But on The Owl House TikTok, I discovered another Disney show that also seems to have the same plot similar to The Owl House. A woman of color gets magically teleported into an alternate dimension. In that alternate dimension, they live with a sexy older parental figure and their kids. From there, they discover that this new world has dark secrets and tyrants wanting to rule over this land and more. And because of that, the main character, with an ethnic last name, has to team up with the people that surround them and take those tyrants down. I held out watching this show for so long, and for no reason. I just never wanted to watch it. But at this point, I was desperate. The Owl House hiatus was, and still is, going strong, and I finished rewatching so many shows to count that I needed something new. I finally decided to watch Amphibia, and in doing so, I discovered my favorite animated TV show. And in this video, I'm going to explain to you as to why that show was so great.
Woke up in Utopia, where I fell down a flight of stairs.
I really do love this show. And I want people to watch it, so I think it's only fair that if I talk about everything bad about the show first, then everything good last, you can get a good gauge as to how the show is, and from there you can form your own opinion. So, with that being said, let's start with the bad stuff.
I walked in that motherfucker not giving a fuck, and I walked out that bitch not giving a fuck.
This show does a lot of things right, and if not better than a lot of shows out there, but what it doesn't do right is pacing out filler. Granted, it's not as bad as Steven Universe's. Nothing can be as bad as that show's filler, and for a specific reason. That show, when it has filler, doesn't do much with the events of the episode. For example, one of the episodes of Steven Universe where Steven finds an hourglass thing that takes him back in time, nothing Steven learns, interacts with, or runs into comes back later in the show. And not only does that episode fall victim to that type of filler, but so do many more. Granted, or should I say, granite. Because rock. Sometimes adventures like those are fun to watch, but if they have literally zero plot relevance, then what's the point of watching them? But with Amphibia, even though I'd say like 45% of the show is quote-unquote filler, I'd argue that only around 15% of that show is zero plot relevance filler. Now, I'll get into why that's a good thing when we talk about all the good aspects of this show, because the way that this show utilizes its filler is really good, but when the show is just boring, bland filler, it does get tedious to watch the show. I've said that the show is my favorite animated show out there, but even then, like, I'm rewatching the show with my partner right now, and holy hell, watching those zero plot relevance episodes are a real trek to get through, especially when the comedy is lacking. And speaking about comedy, let's talk.
Are you actually joking, boss man?
Now, this show is one of the funniest shows out there, but we're not here to talk about good quite yet. I'd argue that the show is consistently funny, but like every show, Amphibia can miss with their jokes, and when they do, it can really not be good. Sometimes the jokes are outdated or overused or hell, just not funny at all, so on the off chance that they miss, it just stands out a lot. But not enough to say that the show is unfunny, it's just notable.
Dang it! It's the stupid controller's fault! I was so close to—
Oh, brother, this guy stinks!
The important thing is family and friendship, honesty, values, and no one got arrested.
This show is a show that likes to have life lessons at the end of most of their episodes, which I don't mind. Most of them are acceptable, but a lot of the time, the life lessons that they learn are almost always the same. Like, for realsies, one episode can end with the family hugging each other after committing acts of terrorism and armed robbery and be like, "Hey guys, Hot Pop here, what's important is that you told the truth!" Then in the next episode, they discuss their plans of their soon-to-be child trafficking ring. Like, of course, I'm exaggerating. But, like, they learn lessons, and they do something more or less deplorable, and then they learn the exact same lesson over and over again. And it sometimes kind of makes me sick. Like, sure, this show is for kids. But at least try to make these lessons a tad bit palatable. Like, sometimes this show does have good lessons, but more often than not, they just seem like the type of lessons you'd learn at the end of an Illumination movie. Chris, insert, like, a video of, like, that stupid elephant bitch who is annoying and sings loud and, like, no one likes because she's an annoying asshole. And honestly, those are the bad things I can think of. Let's talk about all the great stuff, because in my humble opinion, they overshadow these bad things.
I walked in that motherfucker giving a fuck, and I walked out that bitch giving a fuck.
Episodes without filler are always riveting. But when they do have filler, the majority of the time they use that wasted time to still add to the universe in a way that makes it seem, in hindsight, like no time was being wasted. Like, on the first viewing of this show, what one would think is filler actually comes back that then makes that episode relevant to the plot. And when shows do that, there's nothing I love more. For example, there's an episode where Sprig challenges Op-Pop to the rights of the family farm by doing the old amphibian tradition. At a glance, that seems like a filler episode, but throughout the show we learn that that is an actual common thing that is used to settle family disputes all throughout the continent. But the best usage of filler episodes coming back is in the episode Hop Popular. Without spoiling, in this episode, Hop-Pop runs for mayor against the local stool Toad Mayor Toadstool. But then during the season 1 finale, this entire subplot is the focus of the main conflict throughout the season 1 arc. I don't want to spoil it. But, oh my god, it was amazing when they connected these two episodes, which seemed to be a simple filler episode, into the central theme of the show. Anyway, what I'm trying to say is that watch all the episodes all the way through, even the boring ones, because you never know if it'll come back in the future.
I've missed you so much! I'll fill you in later. Do you want to make out? What?
Amphibia's main characters are as followed: Anne Boon Choi, Hopadiah Hop Pop Planter, Sprig Planter, and Polly Planter. Now, with the shows I watch, I typically have at least one main or side main character that I don't like. But with this show, I love them all. Anne is an amazing protagonist. Hop Pop is genuinely the funniest character in the show and probably one of my favorite characters out there. Polly's irate and insane attitude can at times be contentious, but get outshined by the times they hit, and Sprig's nature and personality mesh well with Anne's. And not only them, but the rest of the characters in the show are fun too. Mrs. Croaker, Mayor Toadstool, Marcy, Loggle, Captain Grime, just to mention a few, are all characters that fit perfectly in this show. I'm thinking to myself right now, and being honest, I can only think of like two characters that I don't really like, but they're only one-off episode characters that don't really have any plot relevance, so I don't count them. But everyone in the show is either funny, interesting, or just a genuine pleasure to see whenever they're on screen. These characters' relationships seem natural and real, and I don't mind whenever a side character has an episode dedicated to them.
Ooh, hey, bada bing!
Say it with me now. Amphibia is funny. I'd say it's safe to say that it's funnier than The Owl House, okay? I'd argue that it's funnier than Steven Universe, and I'd go as far as to say that it was on par with Gravity Falls in terms of comedy. I know, bold statement, but considering the fact that there is an episode of Amphibia literally dedicated to Gravity Falls, and also the director straight up was one of the directors of Gravity Falls, I'd say it's safe to make that claim. Of course, the jokes and comedic scenes of the show at times don't land, as previously mentioned, but the ones that do really f***ing do. I'd say the funniest episode of Amphibia is the dinner. Bro, I straight up stopped writing the script right now to literally watch that episode, and even though I knew every joke that was coming up, I was giggling to myself the entirety of the episode. I mean it when I say Hop-Up is the funniest character in the show. And in this episode, that claim is supported heavily.
So, anyone want to hear a joke?
Oh no.
How many toads does it take to screw in a mushroom light?
How many?
None. They prefer utter darkness and the smell of blood.
But not only him, but everyone in this episode works so perfectly. You could tell that everyone, from the writers to the voice actors, had a blast making this episode, because it's apparent in the final product. This show is constantly funny, but that episode in specific is a great example of the bangers you'd expect in Amphibia. And also, can I talk about how memeable this show is? Like, sure, okay, so almost Steven Universe, Gravity Falls, and the Owl House memes are hilarious, but the community straight up has field days with every episode of Amphibia. Like, honestly, get on TikTok and try to find yourself onto the Amphibia For You page, because, bro, it's genuinely one of the most hilarious fandoms to be in.
Bro, this is kind of lame.
Yeah, let's go. Trump 2020, ugh.
Overall, from the showrunners to the fandom itself, this show has some very comedic people around it, and it's hands down hilarious.
Eat the rich!
In Amphibia lives a class's hierarchy of power. In order from upper class to lower class is as followed: newts, toads, axolotls, and frogs. Newts are the high-ranking, scholarly upper-class amphibians of this world. They are generally rich and look down upon the lower class. The ruler of Amphibia, King Andreas, is a newt himself. Toads are second in society. They are seen as a vicious, militarized culture. They follow the commands of the newts, but rule over the lower-class amphibian. They are seen as generals, mayors, and tax collectors. Next are axolotls. We only see a handful of axolotls so far, but what can be inferred is that they are comparable to frogs in terms of status, but are slightly above them in society. They are seen as business owners, like Loggle the woodworker or Gertie the nacho stand runner. And lastly are frogs. They are the lowest in society and fall victim to the oppression of the rich. They are the farmers of Amphibia and are exploited for their goods, and are only successful by luck. They typically are not seen in places of power, which is why it was a big deal that one of them ran up against the local toad. Of course, there's more world building in terms of cities, faunas, and history, but we'd be here all day talking about it. But I think the fact that the showrunners put so much world building into the class system gives you a pretty good idea of the amount of lore and story in Amphibia.
Mostly hidden coward. And coward and coward and coward and coward and coward and coward and.
Okay, so I have a life, right? So because of that, I'm not qualified in the virgin arts. So I don't really think I could give a good in-depth analysis of the music. I'm just gonna throw in my two cents. The music straight up slaps. The intro is fire. I'm sorry, but honestly, I listen to it every single time I watch an episode. Like, especially this part of the song. But other than that, it's a really good intro song. But like, something better than the intro is the season 3 outro song. Oh my god. Like, bro, that song straight up scratches my neurodivergent brain in all of the right places. Listen to it. And to finish this off, Rebecca Sugar themselves shows the hell up in season 3. Yes, Rebecca Sugar, the creator of this Ratatouille porn. And less notably, Steven Universe. But yeah, they show up as themselves and sing a song about Christmas during the Amphibia Christmas special. Sugar is the top dog when it comes to racist tropes. I mean, music in animated TV shows. So for them to show up, amazing. And lastly, let's tone it down. Let's talk about how dark and emotional this show gets. I'll tell you when we get to spoiler territory and where to skip to. So just to let you know.
I am always 2 steps ahead.
I mean it with 100% honesty that Amphibia's season finales are some of the best out there. Throughout the show, the natural progression to the climax at the season finales is well-paced and natural. It makes sense as to why it took so long for Anne and the planters to find Sasha and Marcy. It makes sense why it took so long for them to finally understand how to wield the Calamity Box. It makes sense as to why it took them so long to get home. Now, I know you're watching this right now and thinking that I just spoiled it for you, but one of the qualities of this show that I love is that these events aren't the big events or climax of the show. And also, these spoilers aren't spoilers because they are revealed to us in the episode titles and description. And meeting Sasha or Marcy or going home isn't the climax of these shows, but are secondary events coupled with a bigger event tied to those reveals. Here are the spoilers, so just skip to this much time in the future now, please. Thank you. While these events are a big deal, they come with something bigger. We learn that Sasha has come with the Toad Army to assassinate Hop Pop for sticking up to the Toads. We see Sasha attempt to literally commit suicide upon herself.
Get it?
Seeing what she has become.
Hey, Anne. Maybe you're better off without me. Somebody
to be. And we learn that Marcy has become close to the king, revealing Marcy's plan to make her and her friends stay in Amphibia with her forever and go on magical adventures because of what her family plans to move away. We learn that Anne, because of her connection to the Calamity Box, has the power of a god, and we see King Andreas attempt to kill Marcy and his plan for interdimensional conquest. Marcy at the gates? Yeah, more like Marcy at Heaven's gates, considering what the hell Andreas did there, am I right? All this and more are revealed to us with the veneer that a wholesome episode is coming up due to the names and description of their respective episodes, but come with something way more sinister. What I'm trying to say is that the way that Amphibia sets up their climaxes and finales is amazing, because they always take a 180. They're full of emotion, betrayal, dark themes, and twists and turns I never saw coming. It's crazy how well the show pulls you along on strings in all the right ways. And if we want to lean into the more emotional side of Amphibia, I got you. Season 2, Episode 9, Hopping Mall. Again, I don't know what it is with Amphibia writers naming episodes funny whatever names, and then those episodes being so depressing and dark, but whatever. In this episode, Anne wanted to buy a souvenir of Amphibia for her mom. To get what she thinks is the perfect gift, she goes through the usual goofy shenanigan to get it. Regardless, overall, it was a good episode full of good jokes and fun times, but at the end of the episode, Matt Braley slaps us in the face. Anne starts reminiscing about her parents, about how she never got along with them, but the small annoying things that they would do are the things she misses most about them. I don't know, but that hit home. My dad was working in another state for a while and would only come back to see us for holidays and birthdays. That was, if he could take the time to. But I remember those days and how hard it was for me and my family, and that scene hit home. I started tearing up seeing that, but it was this next part that brought in the waterworks. After Anne says that, she sits down. Then Sprig tries to make her feel better. He says in a friendly way that it's cool that she at least knows her mom. He then reveals that Hop Hop is just her grandfather and that Polly and his parents died when they were so young. And because of their age, he hardly remembered anything about them. He then states that it's probably silly that he misses a person that he never got to meet. And then Adam quickly hugs him and we see him start to cry. And to be honest with you, I'd be lying if I told you I wasn't. Like, what the hell, Matt? Why did you feel the need to put such a perfect tearjerker into what was a normal-ass episode? I'm not complaining, but, like, still. When it comes to emotionally charged TV shows, I hardly ever find myself crying on the first watch. I watched all of BoJack without crying, even at his death scene. Spoiler alert for Amphibia! I got through the entirety of Steven Universe, including the ending of Steven Universe Future, without crying. I got close, though. But the point is that I only cry with TV shows on later viewings. I cry because of what the show meant to me, but for some reason, watching this episode of Amphibia, it broke that streak. With all that being said, I just want you guys to know that Amphibia isn't just another show that Disney puts on during the day so that they can push the show with queer representation onto nighttime slots, making fewer people watch them, which then gives them a reason to cancel that show. But is an actual show with talented artists, musicians, writers, and animators behind it. A team of talented people that not only want to reclaim the title that Disney Channel once had of being the top dog when it came to TV animation, but they just simply want to make a great show. And in my opinion, they totally succeeded and surpassed that. Please, if you have the time, go and watch this amazing show. You won't regret it. With that being said, guys, and gals, and non-binary bitches, thanks a lot for making... Thanks a lot for watching this YouTube video. Okay, I'm done. Alright, it was. That's my time. Tip your waiters. Fuck off. Leave.